many of you are returning to Chautauqua, and you may already know the important role the Chautauqua tradition has played in America. If not, I'll quickly explain. Chautauqua is a community-based cultural and social movement that started in the 1870s and flourished in America until the mid-1920s. During this time, there existed hundreds of touring Chautauquas that they presented lectures, dance, music, drama, and other forms of cultural enrichment. Chautauquas were a sort of traveling intellectual circus, bringing the most timely educational lectures and programs to small towns throughout the country. The Chautauqua circuit even came to Keene in the early 20th century. Then in 1976, it was reborn as a public humanities program. Today, Chautauquas feature scholars portraying significant historical figures in first-person performances, followed by a question and answer period with the character, and questions will be answered in the voice and time of that character. Then there is time where you can ask questions of the scholar, who will be able to answer the questions the character could not or would not answer. This year we welcome two esteemed actors and scholars, Marvin Jefferson and Gwendolyn Briley-Strand, who will portray Paul Robeson and Wilma Rudolph. But first we'll enjoy a short musical performance by Will Danforth. Will is from Grafton, Vermont. He offers a variety of roots-based acoustic music, and tonight he'll be accompanying himself on guitar, banjo, and harmonica. So please welcome.
Good evening. Pleasure to be here among the august company that is going to follow me. I have a 100% traditional program for you tonight. Mostly music, not too much talk. Oop, this does not sound quite right. Come on. Well, I bet you're going fishing all of the time. Am I going fishing too? And I met my life and my loving wife said I could catch more fish than you. Well, then I fish a bite of you got good bait. Here's a little dip I would like a relate. And a fish a bite if you got good bait. I'm a going fishing and mama's coming fishing and the baby's coming fishing too. Well, I went on down to my favorite fishing hole. I brought me a pole and a line. Threw that line on and caught a nine pound catfish. And I brought him on home for supper time. Well, then the fishing bite of you got good bait. Here's a little tip I'd like to relate. Yeah, the fishing bite if you got good bait. I'm home fishing and mama's gone fishing and the baby's gone fishing too. Now, baby brother's about to pull me out of my mind, saying, did I come fishing with you? Well, I took him on down to that fishing hole, man. What do you think that kid did do? Got a great big fish out of the bottom of the pond, and he laughed and he jumped. Ooh, 'cause he gone just losing any fish you bite. If you got a good bait, I'm a going fishing, and mama's gone fishing, and the baby's gone fishing too. Hey, put him in the pot, dig a pop him in the pan, honey, cook him till him nice and brown. Mix and match up, but it ain't better now, baby. Two damn things gone, chomp them on down. Well, if it's your body, if it got good bait, he's lifted by the wood like a blade. And if it's your bite, if you got good bait, I'm a good fishing, and mama's gone fishing, and the baby's gone fishing too.
But you don't care about those shop notes, so what you'd like to know is that this is a version of the Erie Canal that you did not hear when you were in school as a kid. This was actually, if you want to be really picky about it, it's not a traditional song. It was written by Governor Clinton of New York a long time ago. Sal each day,
for 15 years on the Erie Canal. She ate beef and I ate hay for 15 years on the Erie Canal. You know, a friend of mine once got her sore, and now he's got a broken jaw, cause she let go with her iron toe, kicked him right back to Buffalo. Low bridge, everybody down. Low bridge, folk are coming to a town. You know, she's a perfect lady. She blushes like a gal if she hears you talk about her in the Erie Canal.
Another traditional tune that people usually associate with country music singers. And some of you may remember this. From the great Atlantic Ocean, wild Pacific shore, from the green of glowing mountains to ice-bound Labrador, she's mighty tall and handsome and known quite well by all. She's a regular combination known as a Wabash Cannonball. Now she came down from Birmingham, cold December day. She rode to the station, you could hear all the people say, there's a gal from Tennessee, she's long and she's tall. She came down from Birmingham in the Wabash Cannonball. From New York to St. Louis and Chicago, by the way, from the hills of Minnesota, where the rhythmic waters fall, to carry them home to victory on the Wabash Cannonball. banjo for you. Cheeks as red as a blooming rose, eyes of the deepest brown. You are the darling of my heart, stay till the sun goes down. Well, I went to see my shady girl, she was standing in the door. Shoes and stockings in her hand, little bare feet on the floor. Shady girl, my beloved, shady girl, my honey. Shady grove, my little love, I'm bound to the shady grove. I wish I had a banjo string made of golden twine. And every tonight I call it is a wish that girl were mine. Yeah, some come here to fiddle and dance, some come here to tarry. I come here to fiddle and dance, but I come here to marry. Shady grove, my little love, shady grove, my honey. Shady grove, my little love, I'm bound to the shady grove. Now when I was a little boy, my mama, she done told me, if I did, I'd kiss the girls, but that's what soon grown moldy. Cherry tree, riper grow the cherries. More you hug and kiss the girl, sooner they will marry. Shady grove, my little love, shady grove, my honey. Shady grove, my little love, I'm out of the shady grove. Playing in the sand. Now that I'm a great big boy, I call myself a man. Yeah, when I was a little boy, I wanted a whittling knife. Now that I'm a great big boy, oh, I want a wife. Shady grove, my little love, shady grove, my honey. Shady grove, my little love, for the shady grove. Sitting in a big armchair, one arm around my liquor keg, the other around my dear. Shady grove, my little love, I'm bound to shady grove. Yeah, shady grove, my little love, I'm bound to shady grove. Classics, all-time classics of folk literature. John Henry. One thing you need to know, the Shaker, well, I'm backing up a little bit. John Henry was a real person. He worked in the mines, digging a tunnel through a hill in, I can't remember if it was Pennsylvania or Western Virginia, but one of those spots there. You know, they didn't have electricity back then. That it was dark in those mines. It was got up to 120 degrees. Men working all day with sledgehammers. That can, it's hard to see. You're tired. And the Shaker is the guy who's holding the stake down there in front of the guy with the hammer. So. So if you happen to miss that little stake with your sledgehammer, you can imagine what might happen to the shaker. So there's a conversation in this song between John Henry and his shaker.
Probably just one.
Okay. was checking.
Good job.
So, finish up with the Woody Guthrie song.
We'll be planning next year's Chautauqua very soon. So if you have ideas, let me know. There will be an evaluation, and that's a good time to share them. But just talking about next year's Chautauqua, I just thought I would say, I know that you guys have put up with a lot of hot Chautauquas in this room. So that's why we moved them to September. And then once we moved them to September, all the other, besides this year, September's were really hot. But this year it's worked out great. It's a nice night. But this actually may be
the last Chautauqua that we have in a non-air-conditioned building, because we are hoping to be able to get this room air-conditioned by the next time we have Chautauqua. So, yay! And hey, so tonight's Chautauqua, the theme is called Activist Athletes. And we will be having people come up to the stage and they will portray Paul Robeson, who was an athlete, but a lot more, and Wilma Rudolph, who also was an athlete and also really a lot more too. And they were activists in different ways, very different ways. And you'll maybe think about that. I hope you think about that and think about all the different ways people can be activists and athletes can be activists or not. I hope you think about that tonight. If you didn't hear the previous introduction, when they told you just a little bit about what Chautauqua is, I'll give you another synopsis. Chautauqua was the name for, is the name for the Chautauqua Lake area in upstate New York. And in 1874, it was a place for training Sunday school teachers. And then it quickly became a place for people to go and have educational seminars and lectures. And then it became a place where people went around the country and did traveling Chautauquas. And that lasted until about the time that people started having radios in their house, because then they didn't have to go out to find out what was going on in the world. And then again, it started up again in the more recent times. And now we've been having them in New Hampshire for many years through the support of the New Hampshire Humanities. New Hampshire Humanities, it's an organization that used to be called New Hampshire Humanities Council. So you might have heard it said that way. They started the Chautauqua movement, the new Chautauqua movement in New Hampshire, and it traveled around the state. And then our library took it up and they were no longer able to do it. But since then, they are contributing financially. And they did that this year, along with CNS Wholesale Grocers and the Keene Public Library, the trustees and the friends of the Keene Public Library. So tonight we have a representative from the New Hampshire Humanities, Susan Bartlett, and she's gonna speak for a moment about things, explain what the humanities is all about.
Good evening. It's really lovely to be here, and it's such a lovely, cool evening, isn't it? I'm enjoying this weather. And I'm so glad to see everybody here. And I just, I know that Gail said I would tell you all about the humanities. I think you know about the humanities, and especially this evening, you're going to get a beautiful example of what humanities brings to our lives with this living history presentation. And a historical presentation that is so current in so many ways for us as well. So that's what we love to do. We love to bring topics around the state to with historical presentations, with current issues that people can engage in and talk about. And we do that all over the state. There are over 400 programs that we sponsor statewide every year. I don't think anyone has ever done this, but you really could be a humanities nerd tourist and try to follow the programs all around the state, and you could go to 3 or 4 a week. You could maybe even go to 2 in one day, I don't know. It's never been tried, so if you do try to do that, let us know. What we like to say is that we connect people with ideas. We do that through our Speakers Bureau program, the 400 plus programs, and we also do it through an adult literacy program, which I'm the director of, and we also do it through grant projects such as Chautauqua. So I am very excited to let you know about, if you want to, there's some print calendars out on the table in the hallway. Please pick one up on the way out if you'd like. You can also go online and get our calendar online and see what we're up to. This is our calendar. And this month we're featuring Annette Gordon-Reed, who is our annual dinner speaker. We still have seats and tables and tickets available for that. There are invitations also on the table out in the hallway. She's going to be an amazing speaker. She won a Pulitzer Prize for her book, The Hemingses of Monticello, which is all many of us have heard about. Sally Hemings, who was Thomas Jefferson's mistress for about 20 or plus years, and they had many children together. So The Hemingses of Monticello is about these intertwined families that were involved with Thomas Jefferson, and it really illuminates a whole aspect of our history, African-American history, that is really important. And she did meticulous research. So I do hope some of you are inspired to buy some tickets and come to our annual dinner. So anyway, have a wonderful time this evening. I'm very excited to hear the program.
So the other thing I want to say before we start the official program is I want to tell you where the bathrooms are. They're up in the hallway up there. And I want to tell you that during the intermission, we'll have free refreshments, and they should be really good. Also during the intermission, one of our Chautauqua performers who will be portraying Wilma Rudolph will have some DVDs of other performances that she's been in for sale in the back. Also about the time schedule, I want to say one more thing about the schedule. Just so you know, like if we get ahead or if some things don't take as long, what we will do is we will follow not the time in the schedule, but like would kind of keep on track about like how much time we were going to allot for something instead of giving an extra long intermission, because you know we've had that conflict before. So if we end up a presentation takes less time than anticipated, the whole schedule of the evening will get adjusted. So the way the program works is I'm going to introduce a moderator, and he is going to introduce the next performer and then also answer questions, give help with the question and answer period. So the moderator is Dan Petit, and he did this last year. He worked for the library a few years ago, but now he works at Project Mountain, but he's also done, he's been our coordinator of the Young Chautauqua program and also the Poetry Out Loud program that the library's had, so we welcome him back. Thank you.
Paul Robeson was a highly accomplished student athlete at Rutgers who later had a successful career in the performing arts, which he utilized to promote social movements around the world. Robeson was especially noted for his rendition of Old Man River in a musical Showboat and for his groundbreaking lead performance in Shakespeare's Othello. In time, however, Robeson's social activism eclipsed his career as a performer and his radical political beliefs eroded his mainstream popularity. So I'd like to introduce Paul Robeson.
Ladder, we are climbing Jacob ladder. We are climbing Jacob ladder, soldiers of the cross. Rise and shine and give God the glory. Rise and shine and give God the glory. Rise and shine and give God the glory, we're soldiers of the cross. Every round goes higher and higher, every round goes higher and higher, every round goes higher and higher, we're soldiers of the cross. are climbing Jacob ladder. We are climbing Jacob ladder. We are climbing Jacob ladder. We're soldiers of the cross. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
I'm pleased to be here, and I have some good news. I just received my passport. It was a long time coming. For those of you who may not know, my right to travel, my passport was taken away from me in 1950 because of my alleged beliefs and my association. But the Supreme Court, to their credit, in this year, 1958, decided that you cannot take away a person's right to travel because of their political beliefs. Now, usually, when asked this question, what are my political beliefs, I would answer, it's none of your business. But because I believe I'm among friends, I will delve into it a little bit more deeply. In 1946, I would call before the Tenney Committee. Now, the Tenney Committee is a joint House and Senate committee started in California, allegedly to root out communism. And I would call before the committee and I would ask the question whether or not I was a communist, which I answered under oath that I was not. Although, it is a known fact that since the 1930s, I am a socialist. For me, socialism represents humankind at a higher stage of existence. From tribalism to feudalism, feudalism to capitalism, capitalism to socialism represents humankind growing and evolving. It has nothing to do with plots or conspiracies. I've never been a part of any plot or conspiracy, and I don't know anyone who has. This was well known, certainly, by 1946. Also, it was well known that I am an anti-fascist, and I was involved in the anti-fascist movement. While in London in the 1930s, I became acquainted with various people. And when I traveled to the Soviet Union in 1934, we made a stop in Germany, in Berlin. And there was an incident that took place. And that incident disturbed me greatly. And I knew that fascism had to be fought wherever it was found, either in Germany or Italy or Spain, in which I was personally involved, the Spanish Civil War, or here in this country, as represented by the Ku Klux Klan and the White Citizens Council. And so it was known that I am very much an anti-fascist. I supported our war effort, and I will continue to be an anti-fascist. Now, also, certainly known by 1946. I am an anti-colonialist. I was very much involved in the anti-colonialist struggle. While in London, again, I met many African students, many African dock workers, and they were telling me the stories of the struggle in their own nation. Now, some of these students are people who have become prominent now. Kwame Nkrumah, Ghana, Nnamdi Azikiwe, Nigeria, Jomo Kenyatta, East Africa. These men are friends of mine. I co-founded in 1937 the Council on African Affairs, which was the only lobbying group in the country to deal specifically with the liberation of Africa. So these things were certainly well known by 1946. Now, 10 years later, 1956, I would call before the House Un-American Activities Committee. That's a very strange title. The House Un-American Activities Committee. Seemed to me the people running the House Un-American Activities Committee were the real un-American. In any case, I would call before this inquisition, and I would ask the question again whether or not I was a communist, which I refused to answer. Now, my refusal is no mystery. I answered the question under oath in 1946. The FBI has had me under surveillance since the late 1930s. Now, if I had answered under oath that I was not a communist, and I really was, that would be perjury. And they would have done their best to put me under their jail. But they knew no such thing existed. Now, during the question and answer session of this thing, things got a little bit heated. And someone had asked me rather pointedly, well, Mr. Robeson, why did you not stay in Russia? And I answered back rather pointedly, because my father was a slave here. My people died building this country. I'm going to stay here and have a part of it just like you. And no fascist-minded people will drive me from it. Is that clear? Needless to say, they didn't like me very much at the House Un-American Activity Committee. And that's fine, because I don't like them very much either. Many people have asked the question, who, what, and why, Paul Robeson, why did I take the stand that I took, put my career, my livelihood, even my life at risk for my principles? And the only way really to know that is to visit my past. So begging your patience, I'm going to talk a little about my upbringing, not to foster agreement, but hopefully to foster understanding as to why I am the way I am. Now, for those of you who have been looking at my career as a singer, there is a song that in some ways represents this development or evolution. There's an old man called the Mississippi. That's the old man I don't like to be. Now, of course, that song is Old Man River. It was written by Oscar Hammerstein II and Jerome Kern. It was written for a musical called Showboat that I performed in 1928. Subsequently, I did the film in 1936. Now, when I first sang the song, I sang the lyrics as they were. And they went something like this. Niggers all work on the Mississippi. Niggers all work while the white folks play. Pulling their boats from dawn till sunset, having no rest till the judgment day. Now, I had to change that word. I've been notorious, some of you may know, for changing things. And I went to Oscar and Jerome and I asked them, could I change that particular word to the word darkies? Not a big change. But as I evolved, Old Man River evolved. And when I sing the song today, the lyrics are something like this. There's an old man called the Mississippi. That's the old man I don't like to be. What does he care if the world's got troubles? What does he care if the land ain't free? Old Man River, that old man river. He must know something, but don't say nothing. He just keeps rolling. He keeps on rolling along. He don't plant taters. He don't plant cotton. And them that plant them is soon forgotten. But Old Man River, he'll just keep rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain. Body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that barge, lift that bale. You show a little grit, and you land in jail. But I keep laughing instead of crying. I must keep fighting until I'm dying. And Old Man River, he'll just keep rolling along. That's how I came Old Man River today. I was born in Princeton, New Jersey, 1898 on April the 9th. My father was the Reverend William Drew Robeson, my mother, Maria Louisa Bustill Robeson. Now, my mother was born in Philadelphia. She was a school teacher prior to marrying my father. My mother's great-grandfather was Cyrus Bustill. He was a Revolutionary War hero. He provided bread for General Washington's troops at Valley Forge during the Revolutionary War. He purchased his freedom. And so my mother, who belonged to that side of the family, comes from that small group of black people that existed in the country at the time who were known as being free. My mother was born in the North in Philadelphia. Now, my father was born in the South. North Carolina, to be exact. My father was enslaved. My father escaped from slavery when he was 15 years old through the Underground Railroad, where he may have met Harriet Tubman. And he went to various schools in the North, and he worked his way all the way up to Lincoln University, which is the oldest institution of higher learning for black people in this country. Then he got a Bachelor of Arts degree in 2 years, through 4 years, excuse me. Another 3 years for his Divinity degree. My father rose from the depths of slavery all the way to being a pastor. He was the pastor of the Witherspoon Street Presbyterian Church in Princeton, New Jersey for 21 years. My father was an extraordinary individual. My father influenced me more than any other person. My father believed in two main philosophies of life. One was to grow to become the greatest of who you are, to fulfill your maximum human potential. And hand in hand with that was to be loyal to your convictions. You stick to your principles no matter what, no matter what the outcome, no matter what the sacrifice. And my father believed in these ideals, and he passed them on to his children. Now in 1901, when I was 3 years old, really too young to understand what my father was doing at the time, my father's ideals were put to the test. You see, during this time, black people were being lynched. Now lynching, of course, is an abominable crime. You have maybe one or two persons who are hunted down like animals and killed in front of hundreds, if not thousands of people, sometimes cheering on this murder. My father, being the man he was, spoke out against this injustice, using his pulpit as a platform. He didn't believe in fighting, but he did believe in speaking out. Now, let me tell you a little bit about Princeton, for those you may not know. Princeton, New Jersey. Princeton, New Jersey was a very segregated town. It was a Jim Crow town. A friend of mine once remarked, Princeton, New Jersey is up south. In any case, the people who ran the town of Princeton, who were white, did not like the idea that my father was speaking out. They did not like the idea that my father had the respect of both black and white in the town, and so the word was given, and my father was ousted. He was fired from his position, a position that he held for 21 years. He didn't allow any anger or bitterness to affect him. He just took the next job available, and that job was being a laborer. That job was literally hauling ashes, the burnt remnants of things from one place to another. He was also a coachman, what we would call today a taxi driver, taking the young students from Princeton University down to the shore and other places in New Jersey. Now, I haven't spoken a great deal about my mother. There's a reason for that. In 1904, right before I turned 6 years old, something horrible happened to her. You see, my mother, who at the time had cataracts on her eyes, she was nearly blind. She was nearly an invalid, she could barely walk. She was in the kitchen with my brother Ben to help her place something on the floor. We had an old-fashioned stove, a coal stove. And for some reason, the panels for the stove came open, and some of the coals, hot coals, fell upon her dress, which was very long. Now, because she couldn't see, she didn't know what was happening. She could only feel, and by the time she felt, she was engulfed in flames. She tried to put the flame down with her arm, and this part of her body caught on fire as well. My brother Ben fought valiantly to put the flame down. He ran through the street, called a friend, a neighbor, anyone he could find, but it was too late. My mother died that next day. That evening, she held on in pain, waiting for my father to return home so she could talk to him about what would happen to the children. You see, there were five of us. There was my brother William, my brother Reeve, my brother Ben, my sister Marion, and myself. I was the baby, the last child. I don't know where I was on that fateful day. Some say I was in the house, and I ran and hid. Some say I was outside and I came in and I saw my mother. In any case, the pain of the event was so great to me that it literally blocked out all memory of my mother. It put me into a kind of shock. I remember seeing her laying in the casket at the funeral. but I simply do not remember her. What would we do now? Here you have a man who lost his job that he held for 21 years, and then 3 years later, he loses the most important person in his life, my mother. Well, fortunately, we lived in Princeton, and although Princeton was very segregated, the black community in Princeton was very kind about during the time. Now, my two older brothers, they were in college. The other two children, they were in a boarding school. That left me alone with Pop. And oftentimes, Pop had to leave town to go to work, so he would leave me in the care of the various friends and family members and neighbors, the black community of Princeton. And oh, they were very kind to me. Oh, they would house me and feed me all kinds of goodies, like black-eyed peas and cornbread and collard greens and yams, which I ate a great deal of. And they would talk to me. They would say things like, you're going to be somebody, Paul. There's something special about you, boy. You're a child of destiny. Now, I didn't understand all that they were saying, but I would listen to them. And I grew to love them because I saw them as being the embodiment of what I felt all human beings should be. Kind and giving, loving and sharing, and in growing to love them, I learned to love myself. And in learning to love myself, that gave me the foundation to love all people. And they would also sing. Well, they sing all kinds of songs, gospel songs, blues songs, songs of joy, songs of sadness, and songs of resistance. Although I didn't understand how important these songs would be until I got much older. We moved from Princeton in 1907 to Westfield, New Jersey, and although I've been to many other places all over the world, for me, that black community of Princeton will always be home. I got a home in that rock, don't you see? I got a home in that rock, don't you see? Between earth and sky, thought I heard my Savior cry. You got a home in that rock, don't you see? We moved from Princeton to Westfield, New Jersey in 1907. Now, Westfield, New Jersey was interesting for a few reasons. One, it was the first time I had gone to school with whites. There were so few black people in the town, they felt safe enough to integrate the school. And I got along pretty well. Two, my father built another church from the ground up where he became pastor again. And three, it was one of the few times and the last time that I disobeyed my father. Now, you know, as children, we all disobey our parents. Well, this was my turn. My father wanted me to do something I can't remember what, and I told him no. He said, come in. I ran, he ran after me. Now, I ran across the road. He followed behind me, and in him following behind me, he stumbled, fell down, and broke one of his most needed teeth. I went to him, and I helped him up. I can't tell you the shame that came over me. He was a man who'd be willing to lay down his life for me, and I him, and I disobeyed him. And my disobeying him, it injured him. Tremendous source of discipline for me. My father never had to admonish me again, and I will always remember Westfield, New Jersey for that. Now we moved from Westfield in 1910 to Somerville, New Jersey. Now in Somerville, New Jersey, I went to high school starting in 1911. And the high school was integrated, had many white friends, and they were very kind to me, and all my teachers were white, very kind and giving. This helped me to excel. I did many things at Somerville High School. I was on a debating team where I was debating champion 4 years in a row. I was on the school newspaper where I wrote the sports page. I was on the drama club where I acted. I was on the glee club where I sang. I played football, baseball, basketball, track and field. Everything was just fine for me at Somerville High School except for one thing. Dr. Ackerman, the high school principal, he didn't like me. He didn't like any black person, but he really hated me. And every time I did something right, he tried to find something wrong about me. So one day I came in late. That's not true. Many days I came in late. Early to bed, early to rise was not one of my strong points, and even though we just lived a few hundred yards away from the school, I had a bad habit of coming in late. In any case, I came in late this one time. He caught me in the hallway. He railed against my person. He tried to denigrate me, and he sent me home. Now, when I got home, my father wanted to do two things. Why was I sent home so early? And two, if I had done something wrong, why wasn't I You see, back in those days, teachers and administrators had the right to spank their students if they were wayward. But I had something to say about that I could not look upon. I'm getting a little bit bigger now. Now, I don't care what you do to me, but if that old hateful principal puts his hands on me, I'm going to try my best to break his neck. Now, my father must have understood it because he knew the kind of man Dr. Ackerman was, so he let it go at that. But despite Dr. Ackerman, despite him, I graduated from Somerville High School, the top of my class. Now, in 1915, there was an examination, a test that was given by the state of New Jersey for a full 4-year academic scholarship to go to Rutgers College, which is now Rutgers University. Now, I wanted to go to Lincoln University like my father and my brother William, but because we didn't have much money, it was decided I would take the test, pass it, get the scholarship, go to Rutgers, that's that. Much easier said than done, believe me. I studied so hard I thought my brain was going to explode. I kept studying and reading late into the night. And I took that test, and I passed it. And I got a scholarship, and something happened within me. Something clicked. I knew equality made me deny me, but I knew I was not inferior to anyone or anybody. So with this newfound confidence in myself, I went to Rutgers College. And because I had done so well on the Somerville football team, I decided I was going to join the Rutgers football team. Feel free to laugh. I must have looked like a fool coming down the road, a lamb innocently going to the slaughterhouse. Let me tell you what happened, keeping in mind when I went to Rutgers in my first year there, I was the only black person there. The only one, think about that. I stepped onto the football field hoping to try out for the team. I saw nothing but older, angry white football players who really didn't want me there. I attempted to make a play. Someone ran up to me, punching me in my face, breaking my nose. My whole face was bloody. Before I got a chance to respond, someone dropped their knee on my shoulder, dislocating it. And then a whole mob of football players gathered around me, punching me, beating me, kicking me, stomping me. This went on for the entire scrimmage. I was almost killed that day. I was lucky to escape with my life. I had to stay in bed for 10 days straight, and I was a very, very sorry boy. Now, my brother William comes to visit me, and I'm pouring my heart out to him, telling him, William, I've got to find some way to get out of Rutgers. If I don't, they're going to kill me. And this is what William says to me. Well, Paul, I understand what you mean. But I would hate to think, and I'm sure Pop would hate to think, that our family had a quitter in it. You see, that William had a way with words. He knew Pop would not accept quitting. And my father had oftentimes told me that to be the first in anything, particularly if you're black, means you have to take whatever they give you, because you're going to make it easier for the next black person who's coming in behind you. So I went back to Rutgers, and I tried out again for the Rutgers football team. Now, this time, I drew eyes in the back of my head, because that wasn't going to happen to me again. I tried out again for the Rutgers football team. I made a lot of good plays, and I made a tackle. But as I lay on my face, my right hand outstretched as so, someone decided to get up, walk over to my right hand, and step on it as hard as they could, hoping to break it. Now, they didn't break my hand. The bone held. But when they removed their cleats from my right hand, every fingernail on my right hand ripped off. That's when I knew rage. Now, my father was a very peaceful man. He didn't believe in violence. He believed in speaking out, but not violence. But then there was my brother Reeve, or as we called him, Reed. Now Reed, if you looked at him the wrong way, said the wrong thing to him, he would punch you in your face. If he couldn't get you with his hand, he had a bag of jagged rocks But it hit you in the head when if it could. That was Reed. And Reed would always tell me, never take a low fall, never bend to the knee. And if they hit you, you hit back quite as hard. Well, I stood there grimacing in pain, and I thought of my father's philosophy, which I followed all of my life, and I thought of Reed's philosophy, which I followed sometimes. Pop philosophy, Reed philosophy. And somehow Reed philosophy made more sense to me at the time. Also, we were playing football. And as you all know, people are supposed to get hit in football. I went right back to the next play. I didn't care if my hand was hurting or bleeding enough. There were three big men in front of me. I made a wide sweep and I knocked them all down. Then I went after the man who stepped on my head. I grabbed him and lifted him up over my head. I was about to kill him. I was about to break him in two. Then that point the coach yelled, Wilson, you're on the team! And that's how I got on the Rutgers football team. By having my nose broken, my shoulder dislocated, my hand decimated by nearly being killed and nearly killing someone. So I said I was going to join the baseball team, the basketball team, the track and field team. I joined every team because they saw on that day that if anybody else put their hand on this Negro, that would be that. That was it. No more problem with Rutgers in terms of sports. I did very well. I earned about 15 varsity letters. I was voted All-American in football, 1917 and 1918. And I was called Robeson of Rutgers, heralded as being the best football player in America. Now, of course, I could not just play sports. I had to earn my degree. That wouldn't have went over well with Pop at all. So I kept up my studies. And in my junior year, I was voted Phi Beta Kappa, fraternity of scholars. Also in my junior year, the man who meant more to me than anyone else in the world died. Now, I had entered into all the oratorical contests in college. I won the freshman, sophomore, the junior year being the most important. And my father, he was ill in bed, and he would come to all the rest of them, but he said he would not be able to come to this one, so he wanted me to go on and win it. The oratorical contest was to take place on May 20th of that year, 1918. My father died May 17th, and I was so filled with grief, I didn't think I could even walk, let alone think about an oratorical contest. And my brother William came to me again. He said, now you know, Paul, you know this would have been important to Pop. You've got to do this. And so I entered into the oratorical contest, and I won it. And in my senior year, I won that one as well. And when I graduated from Rutgers, I graduated valedictorian, number one in my class. And I decided that my life was going to be a testament to his, that I would measure my life by him. There are times when the wind of adversity blows, and these past few years they've blown very, very hard. And I would hold out my arms as if I'm going to embrace him, and I would ask, how am I doing, Pop? I pray that I'm doing right by you. In any case, I graduated 1919. I wasn't sure what I wanted to do, but I knew I had to be of service in some way because I knew that's what Pop wanted. So I decided to be a lawyer. I went to Columbia Law School to earn my law degree. And while there, I met the woman who would ultimately become my wife, Esalanda Cardozo Good. I call her Essie for short. And Essie have to be said, she was the one who really helped push me and guide me into a career of being an artist, of being an actor and a singer. And so I portrayed some roles during my Columbia Law School years. I also had to play a little professional football while at Columbia Law School to help pay for my law degree. And in 1922, I was in a play called Taboo or Voodoo. Not really sure what it was about. Maybe I could give the script to one of you, and then maybe you could tell me, because I certainly don't know. In any case, while in London, England in 1922, I met Mr. Lawrence Brough. And Lawrence Brough was a brilliant pianist, composer, and arranger. And Lawrence Brough believed in bringing forth the Negro folk songs and Negro spiritual. Now, these were the songs that I heard when I was a child growing up in Princeton. These were the songs of joy, of sadness, of resistance. These were the songs that the slaves, my forebears, sang in order to overcome the pain of slavery. And these songs were not to be embarrassed about or to be ashamed of. These songs were to be embraced and shared with the entire world. So in 1925, Lawrence Brown and I formed a partnership. And for 5 years, we sang nothing but Negro folk songs and Negro spirituals. For 5 years straight, from 1925 to 1930. We were the only ones who have done that. Also, my acting career sort of took off at the same time. In 1924, 1925, I was approached by Eugene O'Neill, the great playwright, to act in a play that he had written especially for me called All God's Children Got Wings. It was about interracial love. Now, the Ku Klux Klan had somehow heard about this. And they said, well, if we see there's a scene in the play where I hold her hand or she holds mine and I might kiss her or something of that nature. In any case, they said, well, if this happens, we will burn the theater down and blood will run in the streets. Eugene said, okay, let's just hold off on that play and let's do a revival of the Emperor Jones. And so I did. I did not originate the role. That was originated by Charles Gilbert. But in the revival, it was a huge success. And then eventually we opened up, All God's Children Got Wings, and no blood ran in the streets, and no theater was burned. It was successful as well. This was during the time of the Harlem Renaissance. New ideas, new concepts, new thoughts of what it was to be a black person, to be a Negro, the new Negro in these United States. It was a very exciting time. I, along with many others, followed the concept of a Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, who believed at the time in the talented 10th, that is 10% of the most enlightened, the most knowledgeable, the most educated of the black race would act as a light, as a beacon for the rest of the masses. And we struggled mightily to be that light. But something happened. I went to London, initially to work in 1927, and I decided to stay. Because I opened in a play, a musical called Showboat in 1928, and it was a huge success. And I was feted by all the kings and queens and lords and ladies, this and that. But I also began to pay more attention to and find an affinity with the working people. Now, there was a matinee of Showboat, I was coming from the stage door, and I heard these people in the distance singing. And so I fell in with them. And these people were from Wales. They walked all the way from Wales to London, England. These were miners, Welsh coal miners. And they said that we have nothing, London has everything, so we're going to go to London and we're going to demand equal treatment, a living wage. And they told me their entire story. And I gave them their first meal. And I got my theater friend together to pay for a train load, a train car full of food and clothing to send back to their home. And they said to me, you know, Paul, you're a big star, but you're working class, you're one of us. And they were absolutely right. I talked with the mill workers in Manchester, England. And I became very much involved in their struggle, the struggle of the working class. I would do plays in London and lower the prices to make sure that working class people could come to see the performance. I began to talk with many African students, as I mentioned before, and dock workers, They would tell me of their plight, and I became involved in the anti-colonialist struggles of the day. I became a member of the West African Students' Union. I said that I had discovered Africa while in London, England. And then I was invited by the great film director, Sergei Eisenstein, to go to the Soviet Union. And I was told to go there, not be Ezekwe, Kenyatta. Others told me to go to the Soviet Union and see how the people of color are faring under this new system. And before I got there, I made a stop in Berlin, as I mentioned before, and there was an altercation because my wife is fair-skinned and another friend of ours who went with us, who was white, and Hitler's brown shirts did not like that. And so they surrounded us. And I turned to my friend and said, this is how a lynching starts. And I knew that I may be killed. I may have been killed. And I, on the train, I was very disturbed, but I knew fascism had to be fought. And so I began to involve myself in the anti-fascist movement, in particular in what was happening in the Civil War in Spain. And I supported the Republican forces fighting against Franco, who was backed by the might of Hitler and Mussolini. And when I arrived ultimately in the Soviet Union in 1934, I saw how the people of color were faring. They were faring rather well. And I felt like a full human being. I felt like a man for the first time in my life. I felt that special way when I was a child growing up in Princeton, but it was the first time I felt this way as an adult. And I became friends with the people of the Soviet Union. And I became a believer in the idea of the Soviet Union. And so when I came back to the United States in 1939, I was totally politicized. And I saw the ties, the connections between the mill workers in Manchester, England, and the miners in Wales, and my people picking cotton in the south, or tobacco, or sugarcane. And there was a tie. We were bound by our mutual oppression. And I knew that there were three things that I would fight for to the end of my day. One was for the complete liberation and freedom and equality of my people, black people here in this country. Two was for the complete freedom and liberation of my African brothers and sisters fighting against colonialism in their various countries. And three was for the complete freedom and liberation and equality of all working class people, all oppressed people all over the world. And that's where I am today. And I have my passport. I was asked to portray Othello again at Stratford-on-Avon, and I believe I'll take him up on it. It will be good to see those who supported me throughout these very difficult years. I would like to close by singing a song, and it's the same song I sang initially when I started, but I'm going to change the lyrics a little bit. When I first sang, I said soldiers of the cross, but we all come from different backgrounds. So I'm going to say soldiers in this fight, because we're all in this fight to better our lives, and we're all in this fight to better the lives of those around us. And when I began to wave my arms like this, I want you to join me. Please don't leave me singing up here by myself. Climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We're soldiers in this fight. Rise and shine and give God the glory. Rise and shine and give God the glory. Rise and shine and give God the glory. We're soldiers in this fight. We are climbing higher and higher. We are climbing higher and higher. We are climbing higher and higher. We're soldiers in this fight. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We're soldiers in this fight. Thank you.
Yes, sir?
Yeah.
When you went to the Soviet Union, how did the Soviet government treat you? Did they ignore you? Did they think you were a hero having escaped racist and capitalist America? Or did they laud you as a sports person, as a singer, as an entertainer? What did the government say?
When initially, the gentleman wanted to know how the Soviet Union treated me when I went to the Soviet Union. Now, when I first went there, I went there on the invitation of Sergei Eisenstein. And that was my first trip to the Soviet Union. And it's interesting because the train stopped, and I got out, and they wanted to hear me sing! Sing, Robeson! Sing! And so I began to sing. And that's when they actually, I guess, knew who I was. But I was treated very well there. They showed me how, because my concern was how the people of color were faring. And they were treated rather well. And it was a system that I was happy to see initially. And so each time I went to the Soviet Union, I was treated with a great deal of respect and dignity. That's the question. That was it. Anyone else? Yeah.
Did you ever have voice lessons?
The lady wants to know if I ever had voice lessons. I'm naturally this voice. You know, when we were growing up, home was theater for us. And everybody had their, I guess, saying they would recite or debate. My thing was singing. I didn't take it seriously at first, but my brother William said, wait a minute, Paul, hit that note again. And so I hit the note again, and so they would always tell me that I could sing. I never really took it seriously. I didn't take it seriously until I got married. And my wife, Esmeralda, pushed that particular aspect. I did get some training in regard to how to maintain my voice. But I never wanted it to be, quote, trained, per se, because when you sing folk song, you want your voice to sound authentic, sound like the voice of the people. And so I never wanted it to be polished, let's say. The only training I received was training in regard to how to maintain it. So, you know, if I have a cold or I got hoarse, I would be able to continue. That's the only, quote, training I got. Anyone else? Yeah.
My father was at Rutgers and graduated during the time that you were there. Mm. I don't think he knew you, but he knew of you and always spoke highly.
Well, that's the gentleman was commenting on, you know, his father spoke highly of me. I'm glad. You know, Rutgers has not spoken highly of me in many, many, many years. Perhaps one day they will. In fact, more or less erased me from even my athletic achievements. It's been erased by Rutgers. So I'm glad your father holds me in somewhat like. That's a good thing. Anyone else?
Sir, did you have a question?
Yes.
Do you remember a little more about Lawrence Brown as you're working with him? I have a record of you two.
Oh, yes. Yeah, the gentleman wanted to know if I knew about Lawrence Brown. Oh, Lawrence Brown had been my accompanist for many years. I would say Lawrence Brown is the one who really shaped my career in the sense that the focus on Negro folk song and Negro spiritual. He had a career way before me. He sang with Roland. He was with Roland Hayes. And so when he took me on, I was younger, he was older, of course. But it was through that union that my career took off. And Lawrence Brown could play anything. I mean, Lawrence Brown could play the folk songs that I was interested in singing, and he knew how to arrange it perfectly for my voice. Very dear friend, and someone who I love dearly. So yes, Lawrence Brown and I are very close. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
You have any children?
I have one son. She wanted to know if I had any children. I have one son. It's Paul Robeson Jr. This being 1958, he's 30 years old now. Anyone else? Yes.
Do you think someone, a black man, will be a president in your lifetime?
In my lifetime? No. It is certainly, it is not because there aren't people who are qualified. But this, in 1958, I, there's always that hope. But I don't know if it's something that I will see. I believe it will happen, but it will be after my lifetime. Certainly, it won't, I don't believe it will be in my lifetime, but certainly when my life is over, it's quite possible. Quite possible.
Yes?
After you got your law degree, did you practice?
She wanted to know if I got, when I got my law degree, did I practice? Well, I tried. I tried to work for some law firm, and there's something very memorable that happened. I was working for a law firm, and I had asked for a dictation. And the secretary said rather bluntly that she doesn't take dictation from niggers. And it was a, even, there were people who even were willing to give me my own practice. But they said quite honestly that no one would hire me. Even black clients would not hire me because they think they would lose. And so it was a profession that I just simply could not see myself growing in the way that my prophet wanted me to. I'm sure if I put my nose to it, I could, but I didn't really have much love for the law, particularly how the law treated black people and poor working class people. I always said if I were to teach law, I would teach constitutional law. So that people would understand their constitutional rights. That would be the law that I would teach.
Sir, did you have a question?
Yeah.
When you were grilled by the House of Un-American Activities, were any prominent white politicians speaking up for you in your defense?
The gentleman wanted to know, were there any prominent white politicians who spoke up for me in my defense? No. No. And if they did, I certainly didn't hear them. No. No. The times were such where people were either on one side or they were very afraid. There were those brave individuals, but at that time in 56, no. Yes?
I just wanted to make a comment. I grew up in Princeton, New Jersey, and there is, and I believe is still, a Paul Robeson place there. And it was very near where I lived, and I am very embarrassed to tell this group that I didn't know anything about Paul Robeson, and so I am honored to be here with you tonight to learn more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Robeson, is that news to you that you have a street named after you?
Say this again.
Is it news to you that you have a street named after you?
It's hard for me to imagine this being in 1958. No, I don't see it, but if they do in some time in the near future, or it won't be near future, in the far future, that would be fine. But in 58, I'm just happy to get my passport and be able to leave to resume my career. So thank you, though. Thank you very much.
We have time for one more question.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about your siblings? How would they be able
to do it? Ah, my siblings. She wanted to know about my brothers and sisters. Well, my brother William, my oldest brother, it's funny, he's the brain of the family. My brother William passed away, no longer with us. My brother Reed, the one I told you about. Reed never earned a degree, but I remember him with a great deal of love. He passed away as well. My sister Marion is still here. She's a retired school teacher now. She's living in Philadelphia. And my brother Ben, he's still here as well. He's the pastor of the AME Church in Harlem, the AME Zion Church, Reverend Ben Lofton. So he's still around as well. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I'd like to introduce Marvin Jefferson. He's an actor who teaches at the Bloomfield College in Bloomfield, New Jersey. He has performed at the annual Great Plains Chautauqua in West Fargo, North Dakota, and Colorado, Maryland, South Carolina, North Carolina, Ohio, and Nevada Chautauqua festivals. Mr. Jefferson.
Does anyone have any questions for me about Paul Robeson? Anyone have any questions to ask me? Question? Yeah.
Was Paul Robeson blackballed like the other Hollywood actors and writers?
Oh yeah.
So he was not allowed to.
Oh no. Play. Yeah. He was among the, I guess, one of the more well-known casualties of the McCarthy period. His passport was taken away in 1950. He couldn't find work. I mean, at one point in time, Paul Robeson was one of the highest paid, artists in the world, the country certainly. And from $150,000, which was a lot of money back then, got reduced to maybe $3,000 a year. They pulled his records from the store. They banned his movies. They literally went about the task of making him a non-person. It was a very terrifying thing to see. And when they take away your passport, they basically, now he was not accused of any crime, but if they take away your passport, they're branding you a traitor. Interestingly enough though, the reason why his passport was taken away had nothing to do with him being associated with communists or anything like that. The State Department admitted the reason why his passport was taken was because of his interest in the African liberation movement. That was why. Not because he was, because there were people who were known communists who were getting their passport before him, but because he was involved in the African liberation movement, they took away his passport and they said, Paul Robeson's travel abroad is not in the best interest of the United States. Any other questions? Yes.
Just offhand, from what you know, was that instigated by the Dulles brothers?
The Dulles brothers. Well, they were involved, certainly. The Dulles brothers, Walters, Congressman Walters, and so, yeah, it was all of that. Had it in for him to make an example of him. And so I'm sure the Dulles was certainly involved in it. I don't doubt that at all. Yeah.
Why did you choose this particular individual to
portray? Well, my ego is not that big. I didn't choose Paul Robeson. I was asked if I would do him. There was a gentleman by the name of Giles Wright, who was the head of the Afro-American wing of the New Jersey Historical Commission. And Giles passed away, but Giles was the one who asked me, Marvin, how would you like to do a Robeson Chautauqua? And I said, a what? I knew Paul Robeson was because I went to Rutgers, so I certainly knew Paul Robeson was, not to the degree I know now. But he asked me, and that started me on this journey. So that's thank you, Martin Luther King. I didn't choose that. Someone asked me to portray him. My ego is not that big. Mm-hmm. I'm going to portray Paul Robeson. No. No. Yeah.
Did Robeson continue to live in the United States after he got his passport? Would he need to come an extra
path? No, he went to London, where he stayed. He went to London in 1958. And he stayed in London, which was his home base. I mean, he traveled to various places, he traveled to the Soviet Union and traveled to other places. But he came back in 1963.
And where did he reside at that point?
He initially resided in Harlem for a few years, and then I believe in 1965, he lived in Philadelphia. And he lived out the rest of his life there. Yes?
The Rutgers ever welcomed him back into the Hall of Fame?
Yep, in 1985. Now, there was the black students at Rutgers, you know, fought for there to be a Rutgers, and certainly Rutgers Newark, certainly, fought for there to be a Rutgers, Newark, New Jersey, fought for there to be a Rutgers, I guess a student center named after Paul Robeson, which still exists today. But in terms of him, the Hall of Fame, because 1985, that many years, and arguably Paul Robeson was the greatest athlete, the greatest student ever. But, you know, I mean, it was all part of the, you know, erasing. Am I talking too much?
No.
Okay. I think I'm folk back here. I'm going to lay right in the label. Yeah.
What do you think Paul Robeson might have thought about when athletes like Colin Kaepernick
now kneeling
during the national anthem?
Oh, he would have been good with it. Oh, yeah. That's in the tradition. That's in the tradition of Paul. So she was asking about Colin Kaepernick. Oh yeah, yeah. He'd be fine with that. Matter of fact, he would encourage him more of it. I mean, that's in the tradition. Yeah, that's fine. Someone had, yeah.
You have a beautiful voice. Did you train?
Thank you. Well, number one. I'm an actor. And I don't consider myself a singer. I have a family who are singers. I mean, real singers. I am an actor who sings. And maybe some of what they had just kind of rubbed off. And so, you know, I'm not necessarily trained per se. I'm not like Paul, but I'm not trained per se. But you know, I can carry a tune. You know, I hope I can carry a tune where it doesn't run people out of the building. You know, that's my hope. And that was one of my major fears in portraying Robeson, because I was paranoid, and eventually I had to get past that and say, well, obviously they know you're not Paul Robeson, so it's okay. But you still, you know, it's like, you know, it's, you know, but I'm okay with it now. So
I think you did.
I'm okay with it.
Sir? I wanted to thank you on behalf of the audience for a very powerful presentation.
Thank you very much.
We have time for
one more.
I was wondering about his reaction to his idealism, the leaders in Africa and Russia that did not certainly come up with his expectation.
I would say in terms of the Soviet Union, his son really put it in context. There's a tendency to believe that all Russians are the same, just as other people may believe that all Americans are the same. And there are, you know, there are people who are liberal, there are people who, you know, just like here. And so when he was over there, he always went with the reformers, the ones who were trying to make the system better, okay? His main thing, he did not feel that Stalin was the main evil. He felt that the evil was the right wing of this country. And so when he came back, and a lot of people were disturbed about this, when he came back, he didn't say anything about the purges that were going on in the Soviet Union. He just kind of like denied it, not said anything. Now, and he really didn't say anything to many people. In truth, he was disturbed by it. But, you know, he didn't want to give the right wing ammunition from him, certainly, because he felt that the Soviet Union was a bulwark between the right wing, the colonialists, and the people fighting for their liberation. And, you know, the Soviet Union did, for their own political gain, help. He said something to the effect of, now, one could say that the Soviet Union is playing politics. He said, wouldn't it be nice if the United States played politics in that way, on the right side of history, as opposed to so oftentimes the wrong side. In terms of the leaders of Africa, I would say that Robeson had a great deal of understanding because these folks were under the yoke of colonialism for many years, and there are fits and starts with every nation. And every nation has a right to go through its growing pains, particularly if they're throwing up the yoke of colonialism, like this country. And so, you know, he would have that's his perspective, that they have the right to go through their growing pain. They're going to stumble, but that's their right as a nation that's emerging from the yoke of colonialism.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Jefferson. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jennifer Smart. it home as a memory and been brought back. And I thank all of you for coming out this evening and for bringing your checkbooks. Yes, you've been, your donations to the Wilma Rudolph Foundation have been very generous, and I do appreciate it. Though I know most of you know about my Olympian career, but let me tell you a little bit about me. I come from a very large family. I am the 20th of 22 children. Yes, 22. I was born in 1940, which was an Olympic year, if you remember. I guess it was a foreshadowing of what was to come in my life, though you probably wouldn't have guessed it by how I started out. I was a premature baby. I came before my time. My mama, she fell in her 8th month of pregnancy, and the next thing she knew, I was being born. I guess being premature would explain why I had such a sickly childhood. Oh, I was skinny and scrawny and didn't have the strength that the other children had. I would catch a common cold and it would linger on for weeks and then develop into something else. I was the sickest child in Clarksville, Tennessee. As a child, you name it, and I had it. I had chicken pox and measles and mumps, and when I was 4 years old, I developed double pneumonia and scarlet fever. Now, Mama, she treated it with home remedies, hot toddies, stuff like that, and then she wrapped me in a lot of blankets to sweat out the fever. Things that worked with other children, but I wasn't like other children. When my fever broke, my mama noticed that my leg was twisted and crooked, and that my foot was turned inward. She took me to Dr. Coleman. He was the only black doctor in Clarksville at the time. And, well, Dr. Coleman told her that while I was in my weakened stage with the fever, I had contracted polio. Now, this was before the vaccine, and thousands of children were dying from polio every year. Dr. Coleman told my mama that I would probably never walk again. But my mama told him and me that I would walk again, and I decided to believe my mama. When I needed treatments for the polio, we would have to go into Nashville, because see, there was no hospital in Clarksville that would treat black people. So she and I would have to get on a bus and go 50 miles to Nashville twice a week, every week, so I could have my treatments. And this was hard on Mama and on me. Well, she had other children and she had to work, but twice a week, we would go into Nashville and they would twist and pull and yank on that crooked leg. And then they would soak it in hot water, and then start all over again. My mama and my older sisters and brothers, they would give me those same treatments at home 4 times a day, every day. I guess with all that love, I had to get better. my older sisters and brothers, they would take care of me, and they would encourage me and work with me. It was a whole lot of love. When I was 5 years old, I got fitted with a brace. Oh, I hated that thing. It was so ugly. It was this clumsy brown shoe, lace-up shoe, and it had 2 steel rods that stuck in the side with straps that strapped and braced my leg to keep it straight. Oh, I hated it. I knew I needed it, but I still hated it. All the other little girls had those pretty little patent leather shoes, and I was in this ugly brace. It just reminded me that there was something wrong with me. I was sick all the time. I spent the first decade of my life sick all the time. I used to get so mad at myself, or so angry, I'd say, Wilma, is this all your life was ever gonna be about? It's being sick all the time. I guess that's when that competitive spirit in me welled up and I started fighting back. I was just so tired of just being sick, sick all the time. I couldn't go to school. My leg was too weak to support me. So, but when I was 7 years old, I finally got a chance to go to elementary school. Oh, I was terrified. Oh, I just wanted to fit in. I just wanted to be like the other children, the ordinary. I would watch all the other kids run up and down the playground playing games that I couldn't participate in. And I would look at them and I'd say, one day, Wilma, one day. And that day came too. I was 12 years old. And I decided on that Sunday morning that I was going to church and I wasn't going to wear my brace. Now, you have to understand, this brace was the first thing I put on in the morning and the last thing I took off, I took out at night. Nobody ever seen me without my brace except my doctors and my family. Well, I decided that Sunday I was going to walk down that aisle without my brace. And everybody would see me. They wouldn't think it was just a part of me. It was the first time in my life that I felt healthy over my whole body. And it was then that I decided I had another goal in mind. I didn't want to be ordinary. I wanted to be extraordinary. Oh, and that my leg arms had kept me in bondage for years. But I was ready to get out there, and I was ready to make up for lost time. I'd been sitting in chairs and laying in the bed and all of that and watching everybody in Clarksville play basketball. I loved basketball. It was the favorite pastime of everybody in Clarksville. I would watch all the kids play basketball, and that's what I wanted. So when I started high school, Burke High School, from 7th to 12th grade, I wanted to play basketball and be on a girls' basketball team. My sister, one of my older sisters, Yolanda, she was on the girls' basketball team, and she wanted me to follow in her footsteps. And so she asked Coach Gray, her and my father asked Coach Gray to put me on the girls' basketball team, and he did. But he ignored me for 3 whole seasons. I just sat there warm on the bench, watching all the other girls play basketball. I watched them, all their moves, but I didn't just sit there. Oh no, I watched every move that all the players made. I strategized and memorized and scrutinized. I watched everything that they did, and I just dreamed of being a star of the basketball team. In between games, I would go out and outside on the court, and I'd practice, and I'd practice, and I'd practice. And for hours and hours, I would practice my shots, and I would practice. And in between basketball season, I joined the track team so I could keep in shape. My coach, Coach Gray, he said, I was always getting in his way. I was like a mosquito, always buzzing around, and he was smiling. I was just always buzzing around. And that's how I got the nickname Skeeter. You know, when I mentor young women today, I tell them about the importance of persistence. You be persistent. You keep going after your dreams, and you go when you go, and you put your whole self into it, and you be persistent. And then my life took another turn. That at my basketball game, there was a referee. The referee was Ed Temple. Now, he was the referee in our basketball game, but he was the track coach at Tennessee State University. He was the coach of the girls' track team. He told me years later that when he saw me play basketball, he knew that he had met a natural athlete. Now, the track team at Burke High School, it was small and underfunded. And so our coach, Coach Gray, he had to take us all around the state so we could compete with the girls all around the state. Well, since ninth grade, I never lost a race. It's not that I was trying, so it came natural to me. I would get on that track and it would be like breathing. And I would just soar down that track. Now, my heart was still in basketball, but, well, track was just, it was just a wonder. It was just like, it's just like soaring when I did it. I remember the first official track meet that I ever went to. It was for the Amateur Athletic Union. And we went to Tuskegee Institute. Now, this was the first time I'd been on a college campus, and I was mesmerized by it. And all the girls, they were so good. But you remember what I said, I never lost the track meet. So, well, I was a little cocky. I just knew I had never lost, and I'd beat all of these girls before. But you know, that track meet, it taught me a life lesson. It taught me that raw talent couldn't hold a candle to experience and superior training. And so I learned a lesson as I got beat at that track meet. So I was surprised when the coach Temple asked me to go to Tennessee State for the summer and train with the women's track team, the Tiger Bells. And I was even more surprised when my parents let me go. Now, at first my daddy said no. He said, no, you cannot go that far by yourself. But then my mama, she worked on him. And she talked to him, and she reminded him that I was the first one in the family that would have a chance to go to college. And she said, if it was going to be through running, then I was to run, and I was to run all the way and be the best that I could be. So I went off for that summer to Tennessee State. And Coach Temple, he was relentless. Relentless with his chaperoning and with his training. And you see, every morning, we would get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and run 6 miles. And then we would come back, we'd eat breakfast, rest for a while. 10:30, we were up, and that's another 6 miles. Then we'd come back, we'd have lunch, we'd rest for a while. 3 o'clock, out there again, another 6 miles. Now this was a daily routine for us. The coach, he worked with us without training, and he taught us the proper way to run, and he told me to keep my hands loose, not all balled up and tense. Keep them loose and keep my arms loose while I was running. And he taught us about breathing. Relax without breathing as we're running down that track. And he worked with my starts. See, I always had the worst starts of any sprinter in any Olympic team. I guess it was my size and my reflexes were slow when I started out. So I would always have to work and practice with those starting blocks. I spent hours working with so that I could get that start better. Coach always said, a better start made a better finish. So I always worked on my starts. And he always stressed. He said, girls, you're a team, not a bunch of individuals. You're a team and you're to think like a team. Well, on the weekends, we would, well, we'd go to church, we'd play cards, we'd watch movies, the family would come. And then by the end of that summer, I got an amazing opportunity. Coach said he wanted me to go with the Tiger Bells and compete in the 1956 Olympics in Melbourne, Australia. Before that summer, I had never even heard of the Olympics. But now he wanted me to participate in the Olympics. And it was like 2 weeks later, and we were off to Seattle, Washington for the Olympic tryouts, and I qualified. I qualified for the 200 heat. And then there I was, a member of the U.S. Olympic team, the youngest member at 16 years old, on my way to Melbourne, Australia. And all the athletes from all over the world were there. It was an amazing, amazing opportunity. When we landed, after the Olympics landed back in Nashville, I had my bronze medal for the 400 meter relay. All the types of bells. I had a bronze medal. And at school, all the kids met me in the gym, and everybody wanted to touch my medal. They wanted to hold it. There were fingerprints all over it. It was just the most amazing time in my life, at that time in my life, until Rome, 1960, Rome. There was no more bronze in Rome. Rome was gold. Gold in the 100, gold in the 200, and gold in the 400. Gold. It was just amazing for my team and all of the athletes that I had met there. My friend Cassius Clay, that's what we called him then. Muhammad Ali is who it is. Now all kinds of all the people that I met. When that plane landed after the 1960 Olympics in Nashville, the whole world met us there. Oh, there were newspaper writers there, the cameras, the television, everybody, the mayors, the crowds that threw a parade for me. The governor came. It was just amazing. And I'd go around and I'd talk to all of the young people, and then I was whisked off. It wasn't but a couple of weeks later, I went on international and national tours. I was the ambassador to West Africa. And I got to talk to all of the young people all over the world. I sat with kings and queens and the president of the United States. I was all over. And you know, after a while, that was exciting, because I was still competing and I was breaking some of my own records. But I just needed some motivation to keep going. And everywhere I went, everybody kept talking and was always in the back of my mind about the 1964 Olympics. And always looking for, what's Wilma going to do then? What is she going to do? And I didn't know. I needed some new motivation to win. And that motivation came. 1962, Palo Alto, California. Stanford University, United States of America versus the Russians. Oh, that was a race above all races. And you know, when we started out, you see, I had won everything. I had all the accolades, I'd won all the awards. There wasn't an award I hadn't won. I had met everybody. So in order to be on time, in order to keep winning, you gotta be a little hungry. So I needed something that sort of kickstarted me. I needed some motivation. I was gonna do that 1964 Olympics in Tokyo. So when we started out on this race, on this particular day, well, it was a 400 meter relay, and we started out behind. Oh my goodness, and you know, every time you have a staggered start, you know on a staggered start, that when your teammate, when she takes that turn and she passes that baton, that she's gonna make up the time, even though she's behind. But that didn't happen. So I just kept, I said, okay, when she keeps, she's gonna keep on going, and the next one, well, she'll make up the time, and she'll catch up, maybe be just a couple of steps ahead. And that'll help me out at the anchor. But that didn't happen. So I said, okay, as I was keeping an eye on what was going on that track, I made a promise to myself. I said, Wilma, now, if you beat the Russian, then it's over. You can retire. You got your 4 gold medals. You're on top. It's over. But if you do not beat the Russian, then you're going to have to run for another 2 years, all the way to Tokyo, and hope that nobody beats you. So you know what I did? I beat the Russian. It was the most amazing, really, the most amazing race of my career. Here I was in an open stadium getting a standing ovation for my own countrymen. That had never happened to me before. And I never regretted the fact that I retired that day. I went back to Tennessee State and I got my degree in early education. And I went back to Cobb Elementary School where I taught the babies. And I traveled all around and I talked with young people and I encouraged them that, you know, the world is out there. And I wanted to especially work with the young black women because we had such a tough time as athletes. And I wanted to encourage them and let them know you hold on to your dreams. You persist. You keep going and you keep going. Don't let nobody stop you. You be persistent. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? Thank you. Thank you so much. I hope there's some persistent people in this. Thank you. Anybody have? Yes, ma'am.
Did your parents want to see you run in the Olympics?
Well, you know, they didn't get to see me. Yes, if my parents got to see me running They didn't get to see me personally because I come from a poor family, and my parents didn't have a television for the 1956 Olympics. But the town got together for the 1960 Olympic, and they got a television, and they got to watch me then. My daddy was a porter, railroad porter, and my mama, she cleaned people's houses, she did laundry, she did what she could do to make the money. My daddy never learned how to read or write, but my mama did. And so it was a tough, but they taught me the basics. They taught me how to hold my head up high and to be the best. And so they got to watch me on TV win my gold medals. And it was the first Olympics that was televised. So it did, you know, it was exciting. Yes, sir.
In 1962, besides the Russians and the Americans, who else, what other countries were running in that championship?
That particular race, it was those two countries, because that's what, it was a difficult time. That was all during the Cold War, and those were the main. That's what, so that was a, it was a big race.
Who could organize it?
Who organized it? That was the university. The university was the one of organizing that. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Did you ever go on a State Farm Cultural Exchange tour?
Say that again.
Were you ever invited to go on a State Farm USIA Cultural Exchange?
Yes, I was constantly, ever since when I came, I was constantly touring and going everywhere. With every group, with the U.S. Department, athletic. You see, the United States was trying to, well, they wanted the world to know that the black people in the United States, everything was wonderful. Everything was good. There was winning gold medals. But then Europe, every place we went, they heard about the riots, the all of the things that were going on, and we did talk about that when we were on as athletes. And I felt my job was to work with and get my colored girls feeling secure, getting them to know themselves, getting them to know what they could do, because there was a black female athletes that brought in the medals in track and field. And we were made to feel less than, because all of the white girls, they were considered pretty. They were considered attractive. And they used to call us, they said, we look like apes. We were ugly, the black girls, our hair wasn't like theirs. So that's why you see I have on makeup. My hair is done. My coach said, I don't want oxes on that field, I want foxes on that field. So he always stressed that we were to be ladies. We were to always have our hair done when we hit that track. We would think there was an image that he insisted that we kept, and we kept that on. And even I noticed all of my princesses after me. You notice they look kind of pretty. Flo Jo and all, they look kind of pretty on that track. That was because we, as black women, had to make a statement that we were feminine, we were ladies, and we were warriors on the track field at the same time. Yes, ma'am.
Did you ever do any coaching?
Yes, I did, because I taught at universities. I taught at Tennessee State, and I taught out at Stanford. I taught at these, but mine was mentoring these, and that's why I started the foundation. I wanted the girls to put their hands on and sit down and listen to somebody who done what they wanted to do. So I spent so much time with young people. Mostly the girls, but I worked with the boys, but mostly the girls.
I have a question.
Yes.
So we know what was going on in the 50s and 60s mm-hmm. in this country. How were you received in Australia and Italy by the people there?
Well, I was the black fellow. The black was there. I was received well outside of the United States. And they respected these gold medals. They respected the Olympians. And it was, I guess, the same old story. You come home, I came home in the 60s, and I didn't get the respect from my country that I should have gotten. But my job was to mentor the young women. My job was to set an example that way. I didn't sit at the fountains, and I didn't sit. I did what I could for these young women and set an example on how I lived. And then I was married and I had four children. And I worked and I worked and I worked. So that's where it was so important for me to give these young female athletes that spine. Let them know that they were beautiful and they were powerful. Yes.
What did you think of Tom Smith and John Carlos when they raised their fists?
I can have to speak up.
When Tommy Smith and John Carlos raised their fists at the Olympics in Mexico?
You know, there was a sense of pride in them and the courage that they could do that and that they would do that. And I was grateful for them and I was proud of them that they did that. Yes. Yes. And we all have to do what we feel in our hearts. It's hard to think about going with my team and having to go around in the back door. It's hard to think about when my aunt passed away, and by then we were living up in Detroit, me and my family, and we came back to Clarksville, and a white man spit on my children. These were things that I stood and I lived a life that fought against, that without marching, I just stood and I represented in the life that I lived. It was a lot easier in Europe than it was in America. Yes, ma'am.
Could you tell us a little bit about your foundation?
My foundation? The Wilma Rudolph Foundation. You all did leave some checks out there. I started it really for training, you know, and it's a national foundation, and I started it so that these young girls could get the training and schools, the money, they get the equipment. And then I wanted them so that they wouldn't feel so degraded in their life as an athlete. And then to understand that, you know, being a superstar for a little while is not enough to build a life on. So they had to learn how to go from fame and fortune to be like me, just a regular young woman again. When you sat with kings, I went to the White House and met President John F. Kennedy. He sort of fell when I met him. Then we went in, and the president's chair is here. It's always here. But for some reason, somebody moved the chair ahead. And the president, he's the president. He doesn't look. So he came in and he sat down. So we had to help him up. But I mean, when you've been all over and received all this, and then, and it's just an athlete's life is just for a little while. And there was no, as later on, there was all of this money and athletes. There, there, there,
in that, especially with Olympics that's amateur. You know, the greatest in the world, but we weren't professional. So there was no money in it. So I had to, it was hard to go out and get a regular job after you've done that. But I still encourage you, you go on, you be the next Olympian. You go ahead and you stand next on that podium. And don't be afraid or feel like you can't compete against the white girls in America or all over the world. You be the best. I guess I taught them what Blanche taught me, my mom. You be the best that you could be, and you just keep on, and you just keep on going. Because when I think about it, if the 4 years from not walking to running, that was divine intervention. And I never took that for granted or forgot that.
We have time for one more question, Ms. Rudolph. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
You said, you talked about Cassius Clay.
Yes, Muhammad Ali. Though, you know, my idol was Jackie Robinson. Mm-hmm. I met him at the 56, before the 56 Olympics. And he said he had watched me, and he had been inspired by me. And for a child, I mean, that was amazing. And you know, Muhammad Ali was, Cassius Clay was always going, I'm the best. We had so much fun. He's a great man. Any other questions?
I think that's all we have for you.
Okay. Well, I thank you so much for joining me, and don't forget about the foundation.
So now I'd like to introduce Ms. Gwendolyn Briley-Strand. She has been delighting audiences on stage, radio, television, and in movie theaters for over 30 years. Her television and movie credits are extensive. She is the founder and CEO of See the Fruits, Inc., a company which uses arts to teach American history. She has been touring her one-woman show, Harriet Tubman, The Chosen One, since 1993.
You know, she was a challenge for me because she was, and we talk about now in this present time about a lot of famous people being very private. Wilma Rudolph was very private. She did, in her autobiography, she never mentioned the name of her husband. I mean, the research to find out the names of the 20 sisters in her. It was, she just, and as I said, with her, she didn't sit at lunch counters, she didn't do it, she lived a life that was her activism. Working with these young women, men and women, that was her activism. Because she had 4 children she had to raise. Money was always a problem for her. And she traveled at Boys and Girls Club. She traveled wherever she could to work and to make a living. She never talked about what her husband did for a living. And when she traveled, she would change jobs about 4 times a year. So when she traveled so much, she had her 4 kids with her. Now she never spoke bad about her husband. She just didn't talk. She was married twice. And she never talked about it. She was a very private woman. And so I felt sort of secretive of the life that she led. And it was so hard to find out details. And the other characters that I do, Rosa Parks and Harriet Tubman, that's just so many. They lived so long. She died so young. She had such a short life. She died from brain cancer. She found out in July that she was diagnosed with brain cancer, and by November 12, 1994, she was dead. Mm. And so it was, and she had a short life, but she, all that she did with the Olympics, what she did with these young people, the I mentioned Flo-Jo, they were there, she was their idol. She said she was always dressed. Mm-hmm. And she always, she was such a lady, and she carried herself so well. There's a couple of videos that you can see her, she had so many different hairstyles. That it was, from this big, beautiful bush, you know, to the different color, and then nails, and she carried herself so well, but she had a difficult time. And her siblings weren't successful. So the money that she made, she was doling it out to the whole family. She did love to paint, and she never talked about that. She sold her first painting for $10,000. And she ended up, she had a lot of family. So her money just, so she didn't have, she had a tough time. She had a tough time.
Was she friends with Althea Gibson by any chance?
She never mentioned whether she was friends. And that's what was so aggravating for me, trying to find out this was a woman that didn't go around as a celebrity. Now, right after the Olympics and before she retired, she was everywhere, she was doing all, she was always on TV, always in the limelight. But after that, when she was, her head was down. She was into this foundation. She was into working with kids. She was in schools, elementary, middle schools. She was working with kids. She wasn't this, the celebrity. Type. So it was like she didn't talk about, I was with this. Now, she was younger when she was talking about Muhammad Ali and all of that. But you know, as she got older, she didn't name drop. She didn't talk about. It was so difficult trying to find out more and more about her. And because of the way the Chautauqua is, and as an actor, I could made up a whole lot of stuff and said, okay. You know, she did this and she that, but that doesn't, that's not the truth of the character. And that's why I love the Chautauqua so much, because as an actor, I was blessed to, right out of school, I graduated from Fordham University with a degree in theater. And joined the union, I've been doing films and television, voiceover, all my career. And we have a tendency to skew history in Hollywood when it doesn't quite fit. It's not quite exciting. I don't think, what could be more exciting than real life, the way what these people, and so that's why Americans don't know their history, because we can't get the facts and the story about these people. And then when you get people that are very private, and you have to look, I found her autobiography, the only copy in the entire state in Maryland, and you couldn't take it out in Baltimore. So I had to sit there and read it all, and I took pictures, and so I could. But it was she was a difficult person because of the lack of information about her. But I kind of fell in love with this young woman. Who decided that she was gonna make a difference in the way she would make a difference, just like Miss Parks, you know, just the simple act of, no, I will not give up. Just making that simple action. So she was an interesting person for me.
We have time for one more question.
Two questions. Does the foundation continue on? And did you find out anything about her children?
About the foundation, do you know I called every number? And it's not closed out, but it's like not there. And I called every number that's available, and in the internet, you know, with the internet, you can get on, you can find. I couldn't find, because I said, I'd be willing to donate do something, maybe doing the show, I could tell people actually where to send money, and because this is the money is still needed for young people in sports and athletics. But it's like vapor. I can't find a CEO, a CFO. I can't find any information. And even her children, her medals, everything is there at Tennessee State University. Everything they have, everything set up. They're Clarksville, because when she came back from the parade, they had a Wilma Rudolph day, and they wanted to get this big parade after Rome in 1960, but Clarksville was segregated. Mm. So they had the white people over here, the black, and Wilma said, oh no, the devil is a liar. Oh no, I will not come unless everybody is together. It was the very first time in Clarksville, Tennessee, that any type like that was integrated. So she, when she could make a statement, when she was involved in it, she made sure that she made. But it's so much about her that's lost. I was given, Gail gave me a new book about her. And so maybe there's, no, I mean, it's just, and I have searched, and I want, and it's not closed, it's not ended, but it's not there anymore. Mm. Which is, you never know. You never, maybe through my travels I'll find somebody somewhere at some time that knows something about this foundation.
Well, thank you very much, Ms. Friends.
You're welcome.
The show closes. I'd like to thank you for attending this year's Chautauqua. I'd like to thank our wonderful performers, Will Danforth, Marvin Jefferson, and Gwendolyn Briley-Strand. A lot of different organizations helped us with grants and funding for this program. We announced their names at the beginning of this evening, but I'd like to thank New Hampshire Humanities and CNS Wholesale Grocers for their support, and to point you to our program with the logos of all the contributing agencies. Finally, I ask you to please take a moment to fill out our evaluation forms. We use them as planning for future programs. And if you're interested in joining our mailing list, please provide your name and email address on the evaluation form. We'll add you to our weekly emails, and you'll be notified of future programs. Have a good evening.